Chris Maylett for BBTV. Today we're over in Moss Side at the Champs Camp. I'm delighted to say I'm joined by the man himself here, Morris Hardcore, former British
champion.
Good to see you, all.
And you, Chris, always.
We're in Moss Side here on the roof. What a great view it is, isn't it? They say, Pennines over there.
It's beautiful places. This is, you know, we come out here sometimes, especially on a summer's day like today, and reflect about the good things what's going on in my side, because you know a lot of people are paying for views like this, you know, so we got off for nothing, you know. See all the Pennines
main road over there, wasn't it?
Yeah, City's Ground. Yeah, I had to knock that down quick, you know.
Are you a City fan?
Am I red?
Are you red?
Loyal red. I'm a loyal red.
So you said you used to train on here, Mo?
Yeah,
you used to come out here and train.
Yeah, we used to train out here when it was obviously dry. It's been raining for the last couple of days. We used to have fun out here. We still do train out here as well, you know. Everyone looks forward to it. And everyone comes with the same reaction that they can't believe what's out here, you know. Steel roof, so it's not going in, you know.
Now, Mo, you've, since Phil Martin passed away a few years ago now, you took the Champs Camp gym over and have continued to run it and keep it going. It's underneath it and called the Phil Martin Center, so it's been continued in his name as well. You know, did you feel it was your calling at the time when it did come around that it was an opportunity for you to take over the gym and you know, and keep Phil's memory going?
Yeah, well, I'm not the only one involved here. There's been a few people, Matt Williams, Enzo Bingham, you know, a few of the fighters have been all stick together. Just that my name is more prominent because people recognize him more from this place, I suppose. But it was a no-brainer, you know. When I was training people a long time ago, people were offering me different positions all over the world in different gyms, but this is where the home is, and this is where my heart is, and this is where, you know, I lie. And make your bed, you lie in it.
It's 25 years this year that Phil passed away. You're doing a show in you know, in memory of him as well. It's going to be at the Hilton Hotel. Before we speak about Phil, sort of, you know, and his legacy that he has left on boxing and, you know, Manchester boxing and further afield, just tell us about the show and, you know, the date and what we can expect from the night.
Well, it's going to be a great night of boxing. We decided to do this, as you said, rightfully so, 25 years since Phil passed away. His legacy carries on, and it always will carry on, as far as I'm concerned, and a lot of other people are concerned. We want to do this in appreciation to show people, give people that didn't really know Phil but heard about Phil, what his legacy and what his dreams and what his inspirations were, what he inspired us all to do and to believe in, and the champions that came out of the gym, the normal people that came out of the gym. There's probably 1,000 people that could tell a story each about Phil, how he's touched their lives. And this is 25 years later, you know, people still feeling the impact of Phil and their life. And it's great. I feel proud and you know, happy to be in this position still in this gym. You know, it's not about money. It's not about being a millionaire, this. And, you know, people that have left this gym or gone for whatever reason, we'll always come back to this gym and they'll always say the same thing about this gym. And there's something about this place where you come and you feel at home, and that's one thing that Phil always made us feel, or myself anyway, I can speak for myself. It made me feel quite comfortable in this place, you know, even though it wasn't, the training wasn't comfortable. It was hard, but you know, I felt safe. I felt love, and you know, I felt like I belong here, and this is why I'm still here today.
When you remember Phil, what are the endearing things about him? You know, as a boxing coach, his legacy, you know, stands and goes before him. But as a person as well, what type of person was he?
Phil was just he was very, 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 very special person to everybody, not just me. I can talk on everybody's behalf here in the gym. It made normal fighters to be something, and to somebody as well up to this day. You know, we didn't just see the small picture, seeing the big picture. You know, you could see the potential with somebody straight away without even him training him. You know, we knew what he's looking for, he knew where we need to be, and he knew exactly where we were going. He's the only one that had that dream, because when we moved in this place here, you know, none of us believed that this gym would be, never mind the success that it endured, I'm talking about the actual building itself, no actual brickwork. We could not see a gym out of this place. This is just total shell, nothing here. Burnt, ruined, rotted out place, you know. The logs were soaked with damp. There was no ceilings, no extension, and just a big hole basically. And he seen it all and we couldn't see nothing until it was nearly finished. We could see what was going on then. But this is like a dead end building for as far as we're concerned, you know.
Yeah, he had a dream and a vision, didn't he, for the area and you know, for the future of being a coach. As a, I mean, he did everything. He was not only a trainer, but he manages his fighters. He also became a promoter to put on his own shows to get you his fights as well.
Mm.
He was very ahead of his time, Phil, as well, and that's been proven a lot of things. I mean, he's renowned for inventing the bar bag drill as well, and you know, his name, he sort of stuck to that. But he was very advanced, and he went to university to learn about sports science. And we're talking, you know, a few decades ago now.
That's
all coming to the fore now. He's very ahead in his thinking and his coaching ways.
Mm. Yeah, it was Phil was, and people would tell you this as well. Phil was very advanced in the way he thought. He portrayed that on his fighters, and that was shown in success when we went to these boxing shows and we're beating kids that we wasn't supposed to beat. We're beating kids that had a lot more experience than us, and people couldn't understand it. And the other thing that was giving us some kind of magic potion, you know, something in my side, some voodoo, you know what I mean? But this is the kind of rubbish that you had to deal with. But like we said, you know, Phil, if Phil was still around today, you know, I can almost put anything on this that Phil would have a gym full of world champions. You know, you can predict that, because the way he was going, nobody done what he done in the amateur world in a short space of time, and reflected in the way he did. I always said it when Phil died, you know, I don't think Phil quite knew the amount of respect what he had. You know, fighting promoters, boxing itself, until he died, and you've seen the turnout, what came. I don't have to go through names, but people would remember that and feel the same way as well.
Yeah, he's left that legacy, there's no doubt about that. And
yeah,
you know, his memory lives on. So this is 21st of September, the show at the Hilton. We can look forward to it. If anyone wants to come along to that, how did he do that?
Yeah, we're having a show on the 21st September to basically just show our appreciation and get our contender VIP promotion off the ground. It's a great way to it's a great way to honour Phil, that I'm involved. I'm still here in Champs Camp representing. We've got other gyms representing, Arun Headley, Heavy Hitters Gym. We've got a new promoter in town called Mike Legale. And so we're all teamed up together. We're going to do this thing right. And that's our job, you know. We hope to do this thing correct, as Phil would have liked it done. We're going to see the talent what are coming through as well, same way like how Phil was showing the talent when we were kids boxing, you know. So, you know, just come along, support if you can. You know, it's filling up fast, the place. It's at the Hilton Hotel, 21st September, like we say. And anybody needs to know anything about tickets, either call myself or look on any of the websites, Facebook, Instagram. All the details are on there. Look for Contender VIP. Contender VIP.
Look forward to it.
Yeah.
Now, when Phil passed away, it was a real shock to everybody, including yourself. And you was very close to Phil, more so probably than most of the boxers at the time. You know, I'm saying that because from what I've heard as well. You was on the verge of a title shot at the time. You'd won the British title, you're British champion, and you was on the sort of the verge of going on to, you know, fight for a world title. And then Phil passed away, and you've said to me in the past that you was kind of left a bit null and void and didn't know what to do, and you found yourself in London. sort of with no destination. In fact, you just went to London and decided I'm going to find a gym down here, and your destiny ended up with Jimmy Tibbs, the you know, renowned legendary trainer down there in London. Just tell us that story, Mark. You've talked about it many times, you know, but it's good to get it on camera.
Phil passed away, and like we said before on camera, that Phil's the type of trainer where you didn't need to worry about anything apart from training and make sure you're there, make sure you do everything he says. So now he's passed away, everything comes in disarray. You know, I'm British champion still. I've got no gym, nowhere to go, no one to train me. I don't know what I'm doing. So, you know, you're kind of left dangling and you got a lot of people trying to grab you because he's still champion. So you don't know what the best move is. I ended up going to London and I fished around a few gyms and I was getting set to fight for a European title, and I was just walking in the gyms on my own and saying, can anyone to spar with, kind of thing, because I didn't have a clue. So I ended up sparring with a lot of people and it was good, but everyone I asked who was the best trainer, they said Jimmy Tibbs. So I thought, right, okay, then that's where we need to be, with the best. So I went to Jimmy, and me and Jimmy got on straight away. And he's got the same methods, like how Phil had, what I loved, you know, what I could identify with straight away. And so we got on with things, and then, you know, Jimmy took me to over there. But in a short space of time, you know, Jimmy had me for 3 weeks and was fighting for the European title. And, you know, we went over to there, to France, and I got beat in France, and Jimmy said to me, look, Morris, I've only known you for 3 weeks. You know, he said to me, so I'm only going to take 3 weeks' money off you. You know, and I thought, he's entitled to the full amount of percentage what he's supposed to get, but he's only taking, I thought, you know, this man's thinking about me, and, you know, so I thought, you know, match made in heaven, here we go. So I signed up with Jimmy. Well, I never signed up, I went with Jimmy. So I moved to London, bam, and Jimmy Tibbs was the main man. The next few fights of mine.
I get the impression Phil was a very much like a father figure type of coach, and very much a father figure to you. I also get the impression like Jimmy Tibbs is that type of character as well. Did he make you sort of feel welcome straight away? And did it turn out the right move and the right place at the right time for you when you got there?
Very much so, you know, very much so with Jimmy, because Jim was. I'm not saying he's an old man or anything like that, but he was older, experienced, very experienced. And I knew and trusted what he said as well. Also as well, Jimmy's I don't know if you know Jimmy Tibbs, but Jimmy's a godly person, a very godly person. And to be where Jimmy was in his life, if you know Jimmy wasn't always a godly person. He's found God, and it's humbled him a lot. And when he talks, you know, he really means it. And I can identify with that, with my bringing up with Phil. You know, he means what he says. You know, what he says, he really believes in. And, you know, it's changed Jimmy as well. It's changed a lot of fighters who were maybe going off the wrong path and put them back on the same path, you know what I mean? So, not necessarily following God, but he's made them think and know that somebody's there for them, you know, not just not doing this business on their own. It's not just a dog world, what you think it is, you know?
Do you still keep in touch with Jimmy? Do you ever?
Yeah, you know, every now and again, you know, not as often, obviously, you know what I mean? But it's weird because when I've been training, when I was training people and I had fighters fighting, and Jimmy's come and helped me in the corner, you know, it's weird because he's my trainer and all of a sudden he's handing up to me, kind of thing, you know. But that's, you know, some people can say that, and like someone like Jimmy, for instance, Jimmy's a proud person, but, you know, he's a real person as well, you know. You know, some people could say, I'm too good for that, you know what I mean? I'm not handing up to you, you know what I mean? You hand up to me, you know what I mean? But Jimmy just said, no, I'll help you out, and that's it, and that's where he is, and that's it. I told you, Jimmy's he's a great person to be around.
So at that point then, where did your career go from there? Well, when you had that European title fight, did you stay in London then and try to rebuild, or did you come back to Manchester?
No, I stayed in London. Like I said, I found Jimmy. I was comfortable with him, and you know, we only had 3 weeks to prepare for the European title fight with the number one fighter in the world, you know, and you know, Fabrice Thiotso, you know, he won the cruiserweight world title, he won the lightweight world title, you know, it wasn't fighting no mug, And I knew damn well it wasn't, I didn't have the right preparation for it, but, you know, not blaming anybody, I've done the best I could. Jimmy done remarkable things and made the best he could in the time that we had to do it, you know. But again, it's where your mind's at. My mind was, I've just lost my trainer. My father not so long passed away as well. I was a bit emotionally unstable, not blaming anything, like I said, but these things don't help. I didn't have a gym to go in until 3 weeks before, and then Jimmy done the best he could. And you know, it happened what happened, and you know, the fight was what it was. And I kind of knew what was going in there with everything against me. But it had to happen like that, and you know, I said, right, okay, get this one out of the way, and we'll move on.
So after that European loss, where did you find yourself then?
Well, like I said, I was with Frank Warren. Frank Warren persuaded me to give up the belt and go for the European, which, you know, the right move as a manager. You know, I didn't have too many grumbles about it. Plus, I was getting paid a shitload of money as well, so, which is great. But fighters will tell you this, you know, when you start thinking about the money rather than a fight, which I never done in my career with Phil, you know you've half lost the fight because your mind's not on it. Because I remember winning fights and saying, yes, I won, and you want to win that bad. And you win, you forget about the money. Because afterwards, you say to yourself, boy, I'm getting paid as well. It's like a bonus. But when you start thinking about money first, and start thinking about what you can do with this money, you got problems. And I was thinking about the money when I went to Europe to fight for the title. But, you know, here and there now it's gone. You know, it's how things happen. Some people, you know, Buster Douglas's mother passed away before he fought Mike Tyson. And Mike Tyson undefeated. And caveman, you know. And there's no way Mike Tyson's getting beat by anybody. And look what happened in that fight, you know. So sometimes it's wrong, but it inspires you to do it for them. It gives that a little bit more of an edge. But in my case didn't do it for me. You know, I tried my best. You know, I put up a good show, but it didn't happen. You know, it's just move on. But that's the first loss I had out of my career, you know. The first one was that, when Phil died. So in some ways, I'm proud because I never lost when he was around. With Phil, I had 15 pro fights, and then I lost on my 16th, you know. But, you know, I won the British title on my 11th, you know, defended it, you know. So, you know, Phil done some remarkable things with me, which I will never forget, and I will eternally be grateful for.
Now, when we were, we've got to talk about it. We were having a brewing a coffee, weren't we, the other day, talking about some of the times.
Another one.
When you spent with Nas.
Yeah.
Because when you did eventually retire, you started sort of, you became part of Prince Nassim's camp. You were good friends with him. You'd known him for years anyway. I think Phil was quite close with Brendan Ingle, wasn't he? And you'd come across Nas from years back.
Yeah.
How did it come about that you started working on camp with him?
Well, Nas was, it's funny, you know, Nas used to come to my press conferences, you know what I mean? I mean, he used to just have a burner of a laugh every time, you know. He's a funny guy, easy to get on with. And then I was going to his press conferences, obviously, and I used to see him and think, yeah, boy, this guy's doing it. I like the way his style is. And Phil used to always tell us about this guy that Brendan Ingle's got before Nas was on the scene, before anybody knew him. And then I knew it was him. And then, you know, we started talking, and, you know, we just got on great. And I was still boxing, but I was at the back end of my boxing career then, and Nas was coming up. And then I said to him one day, man, I said, listen, I'll come with you and show you some stuff what to do one day. And he said to me, I'll show you. And he goes, next time we go on training camp, come with us. That's how we started. So I went on training camp. He said to me, come down. I want to do X, Y, Z, you know what I mean? So we've done all the fitness stuff. And he loved it. He had a lot of respect for Phil. He was the one that opened this gym as well. We reopened it. Nas came down when Johnny Nelson asked him to come down to open it, and he did, which I'm proud of. But Nas had a lot of respect for Phil. He liked the way he'd done things. He liked the way he just moved through the boxing and didn't really play it by the rules. He just, I'm going through, this is what I want, this is what I'm getting, and he'd done anything to get that as well. So, you know, Nas wasn't no stranger to Phil or Phil's methods of training. So when I've gone over there to training camp with him and I brought them same methods to him, you know, he loved it. Hopefully it helped him as well, you know what I mean? But you know, that's how it started. That's how it started with me and Nasser. We just went, I've got a million stories with him. And we went everywhere, all over the world training. I went all over the world on leisure and pleasure. You know, so we've had a great time, me and Nasser, probably with him for the last 8 years of his career, you know, so we've had a long time with him, met a lot of people with him, done a lot of things, and we're still friends up to this day. And he'll be here on the show as well, by the way, 21st September.
Fantastic. And you say he was there for the last 8 years of his career, so you've seen the real sort of prime time, and then you saw up to, you know, him getting beat off Pereira. So he was there at that time. So what a magical time to be around. It must have been around now then, and you know, he sort of took it by storm, didn't he, the boxing scene at the time?
Yeah, number one, that it was Naz was probably the biggest thing in British boxing to hit the scene for years, many years. Probably him and Lennox Lewis. So I'm getting a vision here and an insight of what it's like to be that kind of level. It doesn't get no better than that. And when I say you get treated like Super King, you get treated like Super King, and not just Naz. Everybody around him as well. We've done a lot of things, like I said, with Naz. We've been plenty of training camps, Pennsylvania, Big Bear, Spain, you know, I've been all over the world with him, training in Malaysia. So you get to know someone really well. Just change the subject a little bit. Naz is probably one of the hardest ever featherweight punching, it probably was, that I've ever had the experience of holding a pass for. That boy can punch. I tell you, that boy could punch. Oh, he still can punch, you know.
Well, I remember some stories you've told me there. Mm. One of them, you mentioned that he was in Big Bear running. That's another thing. You told me you didn't like running very much, Naz. But
no.
One day, he was out running and you come across Mayweather and his team. Now, we're talking a few years back when I'm saying Mayweather would have been, say, Super Feather or something like that at that time. So there was a potential meeting between the both. And tell us that story, because they went off, didn't they? And had a meeting with each other about maybe a potential fight. Obviously, it never happened.
Yeah, we're running around Big Bear, and Big Bear's it's a place where Oscar De La Hoya's training camp was there, and that's where he's known for. I think it's 7,000 feet altitude, so everybody goes up there obviously to make the lungs bigger, grasp more air. But we were running there one day, so all our boys running with Naz, Mayweather's boys were running with him, and we bumped into each other, and it was like a standoff, more like a couldn't fight the OK Corral, you know, everyone trying to look bad at each other, that kind of rubbish. My team's better than yours. And then Naz and him started talking about potentially putting a fight on. And this is how boxing is, you know. They were talking business, you know. They said, look, you know, you're coming up, I'm coming up, you know, let's get this thing on. You know, trying to get to a weight category where they could meet up. And, you know, so I thought, yeah, this is going to be great, this, you know what I mean? Because I don't know what the outcome of that fight there. People can presume all the like, but it never happened. But it was great to watch that, you know, see these two greats having this kind of conversation in the middle of the morning, you know, talking about fighting. It's you know, we tell people half of these things, you'd never believe it. That's why I never really go on about them, you know. People ask me, I tell them, you know, so.
What a fight that would have been.
Yeah, it would have been. I don't know who would have won that fight.
Because
they're both at the heights of their careers coming up, you know. You know.
What year are we talking then?
Well, probably around 90, I reckon, I think about 96, 7, something around there, yeah.
I've got to ask you,
it
about,
might have been,
Michael Jackson experience as well, when you went to Neverland with Ness. It was a crazy thing, you know, you sat there, Michael Jackson comes down the stairs.
Well, I don't want to talk too much about that, because a lot of X-rated stuff and that as well, you know. But
really?
No, they're joking. Only joking. No, there was we went down to we were in California. It was in New York doing the advert, the Adidas advert. And he decided to have enough of that. Then he said, right, I want to go to California and chill. So he went to California, and we booked the hotel out there, and we just sat there reading books in the hotel. And then, and then we went downstairs, had a little drink, and then came back upstairs and went back to bed. Then the next morning, Michael Jackson's bodyguard rings up and said, I hear that he's in town. He said, Michael wants to see you. So he said, boy. I said, I ain't going, man. I'm too tired. I've been partying all night and everything else, you know. So he said, no, we got to go. And I said, no. So some like 7:15 in the morning, me, Clifton Mitchell, Naz, poof, 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 on the door, you know. Bodyguard comes in, hey, Naz, come on, Michael wants to see you. So we're all like, got in the car, takes to McDonald's, buys us a coffee. We're all like this, gosh, no, I don't want to really go. And we're driving, and we get to Neverlands. So we're driving through Neverlands there. And you don't really hate it that you're going to see Michael Jackson. You just think he's going out somewhere. And then we got to his house. It's like a one up, one down, you know, just a normal house. So we got out. We're still not seeing Michael. And then we sat down in his living room, and then we're just looking at all these pictures, all these Michael Jackson pictures on there. Nice, beautiful black and white pictures of him and his family. And we sat there, and we're still not believing that we're with Michael Jackson, you know. And next thing, Michael Jackson comes walking down. It's like we just woke up. It's like everyone just... not really starstruck me, you know, but when Michael Jackson comes walking downstairs and walks up to you and says, hey, in this nice, pleasant, you know, how you doing? So, all that kind of thing. And Naz and Imogen is introducing us, and we're like, jeez, man, I can't believe this. So we got plenty of pictures with Michael Jackson, and then it hits you, then you start thinking, what? I'm with Michael Jackson, boy. And then we're in his house, and he's like, come on, let's go. I'm going to show you some dance moves, what to put on your next fight, because Naz is trying to invite him to a fight. He's never been to a boxing fight, you see, so Naz is trying to invite him to the fight. I say, come on, let's go. So he goes, come to the dance studio. So he goes to the dance studio in these little golf buggies, and he's playing a Blah Punk. Remember Blah Punk Radio? Mm. He's playing a Blah Punk, and Michael Jackson tunes are coming out on it, all this set. It's weird, so we're just following him. He's like a big kid. So we go down to this studio. He's got a massive big dance studio, like a massive place. And we go in there, and I wish the mobiles were around as much as they are around these days. He set his move off there. Honest, the move, what he put on, you've never seen anybody move the body like that in their life, you know. And I can only say it like that because I've never seen anybody move like that. And I've gone like that, I've gone, just do that again. And he's done it again. And I said, nah, you've never seen anybody move. He's the best dancer, was the best dancer in the world, as far as I'm concerned. Anyway, he could move his body in some position. And then he was like, come on, I want to take you to show me around the place. He's dead excited. So he showed, he's got a big cinema there, big auditorium, you know, big cinema he's got there. Then he takes it to his train set. He's got a train set that goes all the way around for miles. He's got a beach there, what he's imported in. He's got like a river on the beach. He's got a bus shelter from Manchester here. I said to him, what are you doing with this? And he said, anywhere he goes and he sees something, he likes the theme of it, he gets it imported back to Netherlands there. So basically he's got everything there, what he needs. He took us to the shops on his land. So he's got 75 people working there, big men. And these are the firefighters, in case anything goes wrong. 75 of them. But he also acts as personal bodyguards as well, for him, because they're big. So we pass these guys coming in. Then he says he's going to the shop. So we go into the shop, and he takes us to this shop, which is something like 100 yards away around the corner, because his land's big. And it's the same guys you passed in the gate. And they're talking like, come on, Michael, let me show you what's in the shop. And it's his shop. He buys everything in there. There's no one else in there, but there's a line of shops there, like he can go shopping. Yeah. So he goes in. Yeah, and he goes in, and they're going, Michael, I've got this new garment here. This is nice and freshly made, and all this kind of thing. He's going, I'm looking at him like, real strange. I'm thinking, the man lives there, boy. This is his place, you know what I mean?
Mad experience.
Yeah, it's just crazy, man. This guy's got everything he needs on land there. He said to me, don't need to go anywhere. Mm. Everything he needs is right here, so. Mm. Bit weird seeing how the other people live like that, you know what I mean? But, you know, it's this business.
Well, he was a bit out there, wasn't he, Michael, anyway?
Yeah, more than a bit out there, him. Tell you, that guy. But, you know, I had a lot of respect for Michael Jackson. I know there's a lot of stories about Michael Jackson, but, you know, when I met the guy and I seen the way he was, like I said, he's like a big kid to me, you know. So whether it's true or not, whether he's done them things with, you know what I mean, what people accuse him of, I don't know, you know. But what I do know is that when I met him, he was a good guy. He's come across that way anyway.
So he wanted to meet Naz, he'd heard about him and he'd been watching him or something.
Yeah, we know, you know, even when we was there, Naz gave him a glove, a signed glove. How many of them have you seen? Naz gave him a signed glove. And the appreciation that came off this guy, Michael Jackson, he was like, no one's ever given him a glove before. And he's, you know, he'd tell him he went bullshitting about, you know, he's proper, you know. Yeah. And I thought, this guy, man, is something else. And that's when Naz started saying to him, come to my fight, you know. But he said, never been to a boxing fight before, never. And then we were training once in Times Square. And then we just hear this noise going on. A load of noise. Next thing, we look round, and it's Michael Jackson. He comes walking in while Naz is training. So, and Naz, you know, to be fair, Naz just looked round like that, seen him, and carried on with the pads in the ring, you know. Just carried on with Oscar in the ring. And I thought, that's concentration for you, that. Imagine Michael Jackson comes walking in your gym and you just turn your back on him, start punching the pad still. You know what I mean? So, yeah, something else.
I mean, it tells a few times when Naz used to just turn up and say, Morris, come on, we're going to London to meet P. Diddy or something. And one time he could pick you up in an helicopter on the field near your house.
That's right. But I tell you, he said he couldn't land there.
Yeah.
One time he said, I was in Sheffield at the time, he said, you know, come down to London. And I said, no, Naz, I got flip-flops on. I got this cut sleeve top off, you know, pair of, you know, linen trousers. And, I said, look, Naz, I've got things to do next day. And he said, no, we'll be there and back. And I'll tell you, we'll get back tonight. We go down there, right? He persuades me. We go down to see Puff Daddy at one of them hotels in Park Lane. And he's just had this launch of his new album. So he's there, Jennifer Lopez, a lot of them are there. So we go to this hotel. Never seen a bodyguard so big in my life. Come out the lift door and bars up the stairs. See he's in Puff Suite there. We go in Puff Suite. His brother's there. His barber's there. And a couple of other people are there. And we're just sitting there waiting for Puff Daddy to come out. And the next thing, boom. When he comes out, he makes an entrance. He's got this big, shiny silver suit on. And he walks in. And I'm like, I don't believe this, boy. You know what I mean? It's like you don't believe these things till you actually see them in front of you. And he's there and he's shaking hands. And then the two of them are arguing about who's Bentley to go into the... He says, look, we're going out to the launch of a new album. So Naz says, come in my Bentley. And he said, nah, you come in my Bentley, man. I carry my shit with me, you know. And they're arguing about this. The next thing, they've gone straight to the club, Club de Paris, I think it was at the time. So he's in there, and the next thing, they're dancing. He's on the table with his bottles of champagne. The bar said it's closing. He gets on the mic, opens the bar back up. Everyone drinks around him. He's just crazy life, this. And next thing, we're back at the hotel. He carries his system with him. He's got like this big, massive system with him. He carries all his music with him. And he's got like this geeky like guy, the long hair, you know. And he says, pump it up, man. He's sat on the bed on his own. There's a load of women in there, models, everything. And he's not bothered. He just sat on his own on the bed like this. And he's like, pump it up. And he's banging out his tunes. I mean, it's like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning in a hotel. So next thing now, police come. Shut the place down, tell us to leave. So we're staying next door, so we go. Next morning, Naz gets his phone call, he's got to go to New York. I said, nah, Naz, I got to go. He's like, Naz got this persuasiveness about him. He goes, nah, come on, man, come on. Next thing, flipping neck, I'm in the shops buying some clothes. I didn't even have a pair of underpants with me. Got my passport sent over. Next thing, I'm on a flipping British Airways flight to New York, and HBO were paid £1 million advertising Naz, so he's got to do all his adverts. So we're there for about a week. I was up and down. I'm in a hotel. Mike Tyson just come out of jail. He's in the same hotel. He's just crazy, man. And you're just meeting everybody there and then. So Naz had enough of that place, and he says, right, I want to go to California. We go to California. We go to the airport. Denzel Washington's in there. In the airport. It's just like one after another. So I can't believe all this, you know. So we get on the airplane with Denzel. everyone's cursing him on the plane, so Denzel's messing around with his with her mate, and then we get to the hotel, then all that thing happened with Michael Jackson there, you know what I mean? Just looking crazy. And that was, we ended up going there for 6 weeks. I said I wanted to come back the same night.
He had no clothes, yeah, yeah.
6 weeks, not one pair of underpants he had.
Iconic times, though.
Great times, you know, probably, you know, it's good to see how the other, how that part of, well, now it's a bit eccentric, you know what I mean? Very eccentric, but it's good to see how he was living, you know, because he brought all his friends along with him, and it's great to be part of that as well, you know. Just a nice experience.
You still keep in touch with Naz?
Yeah, still in touch with Naz. He said he's coming over to the show on the 21st, so looking forward to seeing him. Then I'm going to phone him, in fact, after this and remind him. But yeah, I could. He's got a million stories.
There is a load of stories. I could ask you some more, but you know what? Maybe we'll save it and we'll do the Naz series of
get him down as well.
The Naz stories, definitely. Yeah. Got to do something with Naz, haven't we? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. But yeah, there's a few picking you up in the helicopter, meeting the kings and this.
Oh boy, I tell you, went to
there's a lot
going on again. So he said we're going down to meet the King of Jordan.
So, out of the blue again.
Yeah, so we're going there. He said, if you can work it, Morris, you come in. So I said, next thing, I'm on the plane. You know, you're flying out first class everywhere, you know. We get down to Jordan. They're giving us 2 suites each, you know. I said, look, we're staying the same one. So we're staying there, and we went to, it was nice. I've never been to Jordan before. And, you know, we went down to the poor side of the town where the poor kids are. And we seen how they were living, which was hard to see. And then we went to the rich side, where he said the rich people were living. And you could see these two guys standing around, these kids. You know, they didn't look like school children. These are big men. And the kids were the king's kids. So we found out in the end, because every time I stepped near them, the guys were just, you know, on the waistband. And the next time we had to meet the Prince of Jordan, go to his house. And he's one cool guy. He's come out in his baseball cap. I'm expecting, like, you know, suit and shoes. And guy says, come in his garden. He's got flip flops on, pair of shorts, and baseball cap. That's why this guy's cool. And then we have to go meet his brother. He's the King of Jordan, and he come out like a king. Yeah. When we got in there, we're going through all this security point. You know, pure armed guards everywhere. You know, in the middle of a country, you know. And they're all speaking Arabic. I can't understand anything, you know. We get down to the guard, get down to the palace, sorry. We get like people coming checking us out, you know, talking to us and, you know, making sure we are who we are, kind of thing, and just asking us questions. And then next thing now, he said, the king's ready to meet you, so we go outside the room and they tell us how we can conduct ourselves in front of the king. We can't talk unless he speaks to you. So we get outside the room, I'm just like all excited, like a little kid. And he's standing there with about 20 guys around him. And he's only about that big. I mean, he comes up and he's shaking hands and he's, you know, proper nice person he was. You know, and he sat down with us, asking us how the trip was and how things were. And just nice to see how people are living like that. And he just felt power, you know, when you was there, he just felt, this man's got some power, you know. That's how he could feel. But it's another experience as well. And then we left.
Naz over there.
Pardon?
Are they inviting Naz over there?
Yeah, Naz is still very popular with a lot of Arabic people, a lot of Muslim people. Still very popular because I've been to Yemen with Naz, where he's from, which I would never have gone, probably, but I'm glad I did. And I went to Yemen to meet the then president of Yemen. And, you know, I would never have done these things. And I went down there with Naz. You know, he's gone in the room, take out the Rolex watch, he's giving us and giving us one, you know, and I'm like, you know. You know, so done things there, you know, that I would never normally do, you know. When I went to Yemen, Naz said, when you get here, Morris, you're gonna see things that are gonna surprise and shock you and that. And we got on the runway, and you know, the clash in the cuff, you know what I mean, all this was going on, and I couldn't believe what I was seeing in there, you know. And went down to their hotel. I got the king's bodyguards. When we go in, there's blue lights all around us. Guys hanging off the tops with clashing the cuffs like this, getting everyone to move out of the way. It's mad. You would have thought we were the president, you know what I mean? Yeah, it's carrying on. So, you know, seeing that side of things as well. You know, seeing the way how them people live as well. And it's, I won't be going there now though anytime soon, you know me. At the current stage of things.
Great
current
times,
state of things.
Great times. Well, he was in camp for the Barrera fight. And,
yeah.
And that's sort of his first defeat.
Yeah.
What do you feel it was down to? I mean, Barrera was great on the night and got it tactically right, but was Naz not the Naz he had been in the previous years for that fight, would you say?
Yeah, no disrespect to Oscar Suarez and Manny Stewart, both passed on now, but you know, I don't think, me personally didn't think they quite knew Naz. It's very hard to know Naz in that sense in a short space of time because Brendan Ingle was the one that produced Naz. God rest his soul as well. And, you know, I always said to Naz, you know, you're probably the best fighter there, but he knows the ins and outs of what went on there. And I remember asking him once and he said to me that, you know, he knows Brendan's worth, and that's what he thought. And now he's going to go his own way. And so you can't blame him for that. You know, that's what he wanted to do, you know what I mean? And he gave Brendan what he thought he's worth, and that was it, you know? So, but Brendan did know him and did train him. Like I said, I don't know the ins and outs of what went on with him and Brendan. I know some bits and pieces afterwards, but, you know, not very nice, but they don't need repeating. But I suspect most of the time, it was good in there because Dominic Ingle is still producing fighters now, you know, so, you know, he's obviously passed on a good source there, you know, so, you know.
Would you have liked him to stay with Brendan? Do you think he would have been better off doing that and sorting the differences out? Or was it never going to happen?
Well, I'm glad he never really stayed with Brendan because I wouldn't have got the life what I got with him. So in that sense, you know what I mean, I'm glad that he didn't stay there in that sense. But, you know, as far as training is concerned, see, it's hard to answer that question because, like you say, I don't know what's going on a day-to-day basis there. You know, some fighters can stay with somebody. Some fighters can stay and have a certain, you know, when you get to that level of, you know, if you're right up there, you're a commodity, people start looking at you as money. And why not, you know, if you're the commodity yourself, why not make the money yourself? Why are you going to grace everybody else's hands and you can do it yourself? So I'm not saying that's the reason why he left it. I'm just saying that as an example, why he could have, part of the reason why he left. But, you know, everyone else is feeding off him, you know what I mean? So he wanted to do things himself, and that's, you know, other people probably know other things, but I'm just saying what I think.
So in that Barrera fight, you said you believed he sort of trained it tactically wrong and got the fight wrong, or it was just his training in general?
Like I said before, you know, it's hard to train Naz, because Naz is so unorthodox. Unless you really know. I mean, Oscar Suarez is a great trainer, and Manny Stewart stands for himself, you know, with all the world champions he's had and the success he's had in his gym. So no disrespect to any of them two fighters. Them two done the best they could with him at the time. And they did the training, because I remember we was in Palm Springs training for that fight for about 3 months. You know, we were there a long time. So, you know, it's not like he didn't have the training. You know, we're there a long time. Sometimes in training camp, things don't work out how you want them to in terms of sparring partners aren't the ones you wanted. A lot of things can happen where he's done a lot of press conferences where they take the time off the training when you're supposed to be training, and you've got to adhere to these press conferences because you've called him at them time and they come at that time and things run over. You know, so there's a lot of things like that could add to what you thought was going to be going on in the night, but didn't go on in the night. You know, so there's other little things that went on there, but. His training was right though, his training was okay, you know, he's just got the tactics wrong, you know, and that happens sometimes in boxing. But like I said, you know, if Naz was left his own devices back in the day with Brendan Engle, it'd probably be a different fight, you know, that's what I personally think, you know what I mean? But, you know, because Naz is one of the best fighters and probably one of the most hardest, devastating one-punch fighters that I know, you know what I mean, and there probably will be another featherweight in our lifetime like him. So I was blessed to be around him, and happy to be at that point as well.
Yeah, absolute one-off. There'll be another Naz.
Not for now. Yeah, hope there is. It's the last entertainer you've seen, isn't it? Hey, Chris. Who was the last entertainer you seen in boxing? You know, like him, coming
like
up
him.
A flying carpet and you know, that kind of thing.
There's a lot come, hasn't there? And there's a lot of done it well, but
yeah, not like that.
Like that.
That's right. I think you was the last one, to say the truth. The last entertainer I've seen, you know.
Yeah. Well, I had mates who weren't really into boxing. He just wanted to see his ring walk. And he's fighting all the...
Yeah.
He certainly captured the you know, the
yeah,
casual fans.
Yeah, you know,
fans,
like going
well.
To...
He was a big news man.
It's like going to a rave, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You're going to his fights, you know what I mean? He's quite
a
friend now.
Yeah.
The
ring walk music,
yeah.
I mean, he had that fight with Barrera and then he came back to UK. He had a win and then that was it. He never fought again. And
yeah, he fought for the IBO, wasn't it? The IBO title.
Yeah. It's a shame, is it, innit? We never got to sort of see him again after that. And, you know, if he could have
recouped
them glory years, yeah. What do you feel that the reason behind that was, that he never came back?
Well, you know, Frank Warren said this, you know, Frank Warren, this is in my quote, this is what Frank Warren said. And he said, the worst thing that Hamilton has, the worst, is that he got married. And, you know, take that how you want, but fighters know what I'm talking about, you know. When you get settled like that, you know, it can take a little bit out of you. Boxing's a very selfish sport, where you've got to be selfish. And when you're getting married, you're getting older, kids come along, you know, it's hard to put that aside. And that's why fighters go on training camp. It's hard to forget that and put that aside, you know. So he's not wrong for that, you know. That's just the way it goes, you know, sometimes. Some people can, some people, you know, can't really adjust, you know. Maybe it's that, maybe it's something else.
So would you say he was content with what he'd achieved in boxing? He was ready to sort of put his feet up and enjoy his success then with his family? And he'd lost that. I think you can, you know, lose that edge to be an hungry fighter on the way up.
Mm.
You know, you're probably never the same once you make the millions. Well, not all of them are. Some of the greats are, obviously.
Yeah, that's right. I should imagine, right, because I'm not part of that, but I should imagine that it's a very hard thing to be comfortable in boxing and still get up in the morning and push your body through and drive your body through all that training regime. You know, when you know that you can just go anywhere you like, you've got choice, money gives you choice, and you can do whatever you like. It's hard to keep getting up, you know. But I remember in Manny Stewart, because I had plenty of conversation with him, Manny Stewart had 29 world champions, and he kept saying, he always said, Michael Moore, when he was training him, he said he was the most dedicated, you know, out of all them fighters there. He said, but the one he loved, the best one he loved, was Tommy Hearns. You know, he always said, I can't, you know, there's no one better than Tommy. There's different excitement that comes to you when Tommy was fighting. And you could see that yourself, you know, being a fan as well, I could see that. But Michael Murray said was the most, you know, he'd come in and I went to Manny's house and Manny had this little small, he said, it's a one bedroom, little small little bed in there, no windows and walls, and there's no pictures on the wall. And he said, Michael Murray was staying there for 10 weeks prior to the fight. 10 weeks in there, you know, on his own. No radio, no TV, no basics, nothing. You know, so that you know, if you went there and seen it, you think, boy, and Michael Moore is one of the best ones, you know, so.
You told me you did that. You slept in the gym for 10 weeks.
Yeah, when I was amateur and I didn't know better. But Phil put discipline on us. He said, right, you got to move in the gym. So at first we were all excited. We were kids. We were like, yeah, man, this is cool, this. Sleeping bags, no, you know. So we all in there. First 3 days was like a laugh, jokes every night. But after 4 days and you're starving and you're dieting, Phil's taking the money out of your pocket. He's weighing you in the morning, making sure you're not messing around. You walk into his house and he'll feed you. You know, the dinners are prepared there. And then he'd meet you back at the gym, to walk back to the gym and meet you there and just get in the gym and pull the shutters down, boof. See you at 5:30 in the morning, and then come pick you up at 5:30, boy, and rain, snow, anything at all, you're pushing vans uphill, bunny ups up and downhill, sprinting, you know, 10 weeks of that. But that's what made us who we were, you know, discipline. You know, if I tell that to the fighters these days, they go, what, I'm doing that, you know what I mean? They're like, but 10 weeks of that, hard, very hard. But you don't get something for nothing in this life.
Absolutely. And you're happy now, Mo, as the sort of head coach here and running it. You have got busy classes and that. You know, on the professional side of things and the amateur side, how much involvement do you have in that now?
Yeah, well, I'm more like overseer kind of thing, you know, because people, like I said, I'm trying to run it like how Phil would be running it. I'm not just doing this myself either. There's you, Matt Williams, John Mucciacci in the office every week, and he's there all the time, you know. So every little bit helps. I'm trying more like to run it like how Phil would like it run. I've got a lot of respect in this gym anyway, one thing that Phil always had, like, you know, in the middle of my side, it's not like how it used to be. It's not all gang related. The most people that come here, you know, I say 70% of them are white, even 80%. The locals don't really come. People come from out of town. So I'm not bothered about that, you know, as long as they feel safe and they feel like they want they belong here as well. And they do. Everybody comes to this gym feels like there's some sense of belonging. There's a great feeling there. There's a good energy in that. And that's a legacy of Phil. He's left that good energy in there. And everyone comes in there. I don't change anything. You know, the walls are the same color. You know, we try and keep everything the same as it was. And it doesn't seem to get old. Everyone comes in there, they know that it's a great gym to be in. And you can feel that when you walk in the place. So that's what I want to keep that great energy in there, you know, which it has got.
Mm. Well, we're making a little video, aren't we, about Phil. And we're going to talk about him. And we've got some of the pictures there to... Some photos off, and we'll play that on the night on the on the show, so that'll be good. So we'll continue that. But I know you've got to get off now, Mo. You've got some training to do yourself, so we'll
jujitsu.
Jujitsu, yeah.
Got to keep my mind occupied, you know.
What's the cut there? Then what's the jujitsu now you
do? Well, you know what jujitsu is, right?
Yeah, a bit.
Okay, yeah. So basically, about 4.5, nearly 5 years ago, I came, Vic Scott. I approached him to come do some jiu-jitsu in the gym and show people, not myself. And I ended up coming here because I thought, you know, I'll just try this out, because we're used to stand up. This is on the ground, this, you know what I mean? So I tried out. I thought I'd be here for about 4 or 5 weeks. Now 4.5 years later, I'm still here, you know. Every week, and it's something great for me, really. Because boxing, you can just, anybody can that's done boxing can show anybody how to, you don't have to think about it these days. As you're getting older now, you want to keep your brain occupied. So, you know, I'm just doing this jiu-jitsu here. Now, I'm not doing it for competition and things like that, you know, but I'm just doing it, you know, to make me think, make me use my head. Because in jiu-jitsu, you have to think like 2-3 steps ahead. And I'm finding that works. This is on the ground, because jiu-jitsu is alien to me, like I said, you know, this is something different than what I'm used to normally. So at first, when I used to look at this, you know, jiu-jitsu, think there's some gay stuff or something like that, I'm not getting involved in that. And now the last thing I'm thinking about, if my head's in between someone else's knees and he's cranking it off, trying to pop off my flipping shoulder blade or something, you know, I gotta get out of there. And that's what I'm thinking about. And I'm thinking about my head's in between his legs, and I'm thinking, how can I get out of there and what I'm gonna do next. It's great to learn. And like I said, it keeps your mind occupied. And I'm glad I stuck here. I'm glad I still got the will to stick here, you know? So it's great to be here. I mean, I'm almost a purple belt now, so it's great to be that.
Maybe you would have done the MMA if you would have been around, you know, if you would have been around now.
Glad than ever. I'd rather have done the boxing, you know. MMA boy, I'd rather get punched in the face and kicked in the head or elbowed in the face, you know, something like that, you know?
It's coming on strong, that sport, though, isn't it?
Yeah. I love watching it. Yeah. I love watching it, and... at least now I can see, some people would look at that sport as barbaric. At least now I can see the moves that these people are doing and understand and relate to them as well. So, you know, I can understand it a lot more. And it's great because you get involved in it, you know? Yeah.
Well, Mo, I always enjoy hearing the stories of Naz. And it's nice to get a few there. There's a lot more I know because I can ask you. So what we'll do a next video and we'll talk about them. And also some of the, you said you, I know you had a lot of time with Manny Stewart as well. So that'd be good to...
Yeah,
some of that.
Yeah.
We'll do it in the next one. If people like this one, we'll do it in the next one.
Yeah. Manny Stewart, these old guys, like Manny Stewart there, you know, very, very knowledgeable guys, you know what I mean? And they could say some stories about if they were still around. You know, even Oscar Suarez, you know, with Naz, you know, when he was in Sheffield there, you know, Oscar was a great guy. And very God-fearing person as well. And so, you know, it's good. Puerto Rican side, so you see boxing from different sides, you know. Manny Stewart's more crunk and Detroit. Oscar's, you know, Puerto Rican, you know what I mean? So anything with Puerto Rico in it, he's on it, you know, obviously straight away, you know?
Well, we came off on the roof for a quick interview. How long do you think that is? Well, we've done
30 minutes?
55 minutes.
You're joking?
Yeah. Time flies, eh?
Time flies and you're having fun.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, Mo, it's great to do this, have a little catch up. We'll have to call this up on the roof interviews.
Providing it's not raining.
Yeah, it's a lovely day. Well, Mo, great to catch up.
Ah, Chris,
see
always.
You. See you again
always.
Soon.
Always.